do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we resume business. And the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 12727 in the name of Liam Kerr on the need for new railway stations north of the Central Belt. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press their request to speak buttons, and I call Liam Kerr to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to colleagues from across the Chamber who have supported my motion today. Presiding Officer, in 1956, the communities of Cove and Newton Hill lost their stations. But in recent years, both have expanded exponentially, such that Newton Hill has a population of more than 3,000 now, and Cove has more than 8,000. Surrounding areas like the lovely new town at Chapelton swell that even further. Yet Newton Hill remains connected to Aberdeen principally by the A92 and Cove by the A956. There is a far from regular or cheap and sometimes unreliable bus service, which takes nearly an hour to get from Newton Hill to Aberdeen, or at least half an hour from Cove. So it comes as no surprise that the number of people who use the car to travel between Newton Hill or Cove and Aberdeen was higher than the national average, as hard-working families are forced to rely on their cars to commute, get to school or college, and to see family and friends. And now, of course, they're faced with a massively unpopular LEZ in Aberdeen, random new bus gates and new parking charges when they get into the city. Now, CNER's Jordan Jack called it right when he said, "Building new stations for Cove and Newton Hill will give residents a sustainable travel choice while halving travel time and will open new economic opportunities." Indeed so. Just think of the environmental benefits as fewer people drive to the city and instead jump on a train, taking them right to the heart of a Union Street which we so badly need to increase footfall to. Presiding Officer, that would decrease car use in a context where the Scottish Government acknowledges it's not really sure how to reduce car kilometres by 20% and will help achieve what I think the ill-thought-through LEZ won't. Think of the economic benefits, with more people looking to live in these fine communities while also working, shopping and schooling in the city. Or as Nestrans point out, the two new stations could service thousands of potential passengers each day travelling to Dundee and the Central Belt. Russell Borthwick, the chief executive of the AGCC, told me just this week the proposals to open Cove and Newton Hill stations would allow many people to access Aberdeen city centre for work and leisure at a time when measures to restrict car access continue to be extended. And just yesterday, the Railway Industry Association, who represent the vital supply chain within the rail industry, told me that greater investment in the rail network would help secure more jobs for the North East and beyond, and thus more spending in North East communities. And they reminded me that railway industry jobs are among the best trained and highest quality standards in the UK. And of course, there's the health and well-being angle as more people take sustainable public transport and active travel. Indeed, the Nestrans report specifically highlights opportunities to provide facilities such as secure cycle parking, cycle hire, and EV charging points. But it's important to ensure, of course, that these communities want new stations. Well, Presiding Officer, 95% of Cove residents and 90% of Newton Hill residents who took part in a 2022 study say they would like to see a station in their area. And almost half of the population said, responding to the study, that new stations at Cove and Newton Hill would encourage them to use the train more. And the petition that I launched last summer in both localities has over 1,500 signatures. Even SNP councillor Miranda Radley agrees. When she was campaigning to get elected to council in 2022, she said, "A train station in Cove just makes sense," and promised in her literature that if elected, she would help bring forward the delivery of a station in Cove. Now, I've written to her and council leader Christian Allard recently to say, OK, how have you actually enacted that? How are you actually delivering on that? Now, to date, I haven't had an answer, but I look forward to receiving that promptly. So, Presiding Officer, the support is there, but what about the practicalities? Well, the Nestrans report quotes £40 million for two stations. Now, that is a lot of money, Presiding Officer, although only about 10% of the cost of two new SNP ferries. But the people of the North East well remember that the SNP government promised us £200 million to invest in North East Rail in 2016. And specifically, Nestrans note that funding, quote, may be an opportunity to introduce new stations on the line between Aberdeen and Lawrence Kirk. Now, disappointingly, only 3%... I will.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank my colleague for taking an intervention. Does Liam Kerr have any confidence at all that that £200 million will actually be spent by the 2026, as was the commitment?
Liam Kerr.
Well, I'm not sure I do have confidence, Mr Lumsden, simply because only 3% of the funding has actually been delivered so far. What's that, about 8 years on? And the SNP government have recently suggested that the pledge is under review. So perhaps the minister can allay those concerns in her closing. The minister will, though, be pleased to note that Nestrans also suggests that external funding may be available for this package, for the stations, subject to the funding application process, and that for both stations they are, quote again, on an existing line and would be serviced using existing services, and therefore operational costs are likely to be low. And the people of the North East, Presiding Officer, have watched, somewhat perplexed, as the likes of Reston in the Borders, East Lothian, Leavenmouth in Fife have got what are excellent new lines and stations. And when SNP Angus Council decided to snub the opportunity of £18 million of free money to extend the Caledonian Railway in Brechin, people began to suspect that this was yet another Central Belt thing. But, Presiding Officer, this government has the chance to allay those fears. The people of the North East have spoken, with more than 1,500 local people signing my petition. Nestrans are on board. Cove Rangers, whose team are upgrading their stadium to increase capacity, back it. We know the environmental, economic and social benefits that proper public transport and stations would bring. The Parliament has shown its support through signatures on my motion. There is cross-party support. Presiding Officer, I'll finish with a quote from Keith Moorhouse, resident of Cove and chair of Cove Rangers, speaking about these two stations specifically. He said, "It's a no-brainer. The more and more rail links you put in and the more options you give people to travel, the better for everyone. Just get a move on." Amen to that, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. We now move to the open debate. I call first Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Douglas Lumsden, in around 4 minutes. Mr Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I thank Liam Kerr for bringing this motion to the Chamber. And I think we will have a fairly good debate around about all of this today. First of all, Presiding Officer, I should probably put on the record that I was the chair of Nestrans between 2007 and 2011. And I am always pleased to see the good work that emanates from the offices of Nestrans, and I pay tribute to the people of the organisation for this report. I think I should also say that during the time of this SNP government, we have seen new stations in the North East, new stations that have made a real difference to the communities of the North East. The station at Lawrence Kirk opened. There was some scepticism about that station, but patronage was over 80%, if I remember rightly, greater than had been anticipated from the reports. And I'm very pleased that we have recently seen the station at Kintore open. Again, that has made a real difference to people. I think that Liam Kerr is right to highlight Newton Hill and Cove, areas that have grown in numbers, as he has said. But I think there are other opportunities in the northeast of Scotland. And I would like to put on record my thanks to the Campaign for North East Rail for the work that they have done, not only looking at the opportunities for new stations and existing lines, but also looking at what can be done in terms of reopening the lines north, the Formart and Buchan lines that should never have been closed, just like the stations at Cove and Newton Hill should not have been closed in 1956, as Mr Kerr has mentioned. This government has put a huge amount of money into the infrastructure of the North East. We have the Western Peripheral Route, thanks to the investment from this SNP government, and we have the investments that I've mentioned in terms of Kintore and Lawrence Kirk. But also, to our advantage, has been the opening of other stations on the Aberdeen to Inverness line, such as the one at Inverness Airport, which opened recently. And I think we should all take cognizance, whether we be from the North East or not, of the investment that the Scottish Government has made in our railways. And the most recent RailWatch magazine, published in April this month, had a banner headline, "Scotland Shows the Way." And Scotland does show the way, because there have been five successful rail station openings in the past 3 years. Reston opened in 2022, Inverness Airport, and East Linton in 23. And later this year, we'll see the line to Cameron Bridge and Leavenmouth opening with the new stations there. Scotland does show the way, but we could do so much better for the North East, for the folk of Cove and Newton Hill, and maybe even Kitty Brewster and Buxburn, if we had more money to spend on infrastructure. But unfortunately, the sad thing is that we have seen a massive reduction to our capital budget from the UK Tory government. That is money that could be spent on Cove and on Newton Hill, but unfortunately, that is not there. However, to end in a lighter note, I think that we in the northeast of Scotland recognise the growth in some of these areas. We recognise the difficulties that have been caused by the closing of railways in the past. And it is time to invest in our infrastructure. It is time to invest not only in Cove and Newton Hill, but also to look what can be done to open up new lines to the north of Aberdeen, like the Borders Railway and like Leavenmouth. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury, around 4 minutes. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to my colleague and train geek, I know he won't mind me calling that, Liam Kerr, for bringing this debate to the Chamber today. And, you know, this is a vital debate for the people of the North East, to force the SNP government to look beyond the needs of the Central Belt and towards my constituents in the North East. Perhaps with our newfound freedom, having dropped the green extremists, we can hope for more. My constituents are well too aware of poor access to railway services in the North East, whether that's the frequency of trains, accessibility of stations, reliability of services, or the time it takes to make a journey. All of those are areas that require improvement, and I welcome the valuable work of bodies like Nestrans, who are putting forward sensible solutions to the challenges of public transport. And I would like to know what the Minister's response is to their excellent preliminary appraisal of the Aberdeen to Lawrence Kirk multimodal transport corridor. And we have seen the difference new stations can make. In 2023, a new station opened on the Border Railway at Reston, and we have seen growth in that community before and since, with other services such as the on-demand bus transport feeding into stations and its links. And it's estimated that the economic benefit of that development will be well over £7 per £1 spent for the local community. And we've seen that it's possible, and we want to bring the same success to the North East and communities such as Cove and Newton Hill. Moving ahead with these projects would make a huge difference to those living around those communities and also to the centre of Aberdeen, a point that Liam Kerr made. More people would have an easy option to come and enjoy what the city centre has to offer. In Cove, a survey was done and the results were telling. 69% of respondents said that there are journeys they would like to make by rail but can't at the moment due to the lack of rail link. Businesses and individuals are over-reliant on their cars in these communities, And if this government are serious about reaching net zero and actually meeting some of their targets, then investment is needed in schemes such as this one. But why stop there, Presiding Officer? The Campaign for North East Rail have also been calling for the East Coast Line to be extended up to Elland, Peterhead and Fraserburgh. The campaigners have been doing an excellent job, and I hope that this devolved government will give this project real consideration in the years ahead. Mary McCallan said only the other day that the devolved government had missed most of their targets when it comes to net zero. Here is the opportunity to demonstrate commitment to the North East, commitment to net zero, commitment to multimodal transport systems, and a commitment to our railway network that is in dire need of investment. And when it comes to that investment in rail network, we must not forget about the promise made by this government back in 2016. That commitment was made to spend £200 million to reduce rail journey times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt by 20 minutes by 2026. 8 years down the line, very little has been spent and no journey time improvements have been made. This, like other grand announcements made by the SNP, seems like a lot of hot air. And I think everyone here knows there's not a cat in hell's chance of that commitment being made. Another broken promise by the SNP. If we can do it in the borders, then we can do it in the North East. And I'm proud to support my colleague Liam Kerr in bringing forward this motion for debate today. Because only the Scottish Conservatives are standing up for the North East. And only the Scottish Conservatives are talking about the issues that are at the heart of economic growth, securing jobs, stability and future of our residents. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Around 4 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to begin by congratulating Liam Kerr for getting this important issue to the Chamber. I welcome the Nesta report. The campaign for the new station in Newton Hill and Cove shows that people across Scotland are crying out for improved rail connection. Rail can do so much for communities. It can be a vital link for those in rural areas. The elderly or those who are not able to drive due to disability cannot rely on irregular and lengthy bus services. Tourists who can bring so much money into the communities outside of Central Belt use trains to see our country. And the ability to travel by train easily will play a massive part in reducing car usage on our path to net zero. So much of Scotland is poorly served by rail. The North East in particular is underserved when compared to other regions. A region which has been so important to Scotland's economy through agriculture, natural resources and fishing, to name just a few, is being neglected. And the demand is there. More than 225,000 journeys were made in the first 3 years of station being opened in Kinthorpe in Aberdeenshire. Imagine what more investment could do. I join members in thanking the Campaign for North East Rail for their campaigning for greater rail connections in North East. Local community campaign for new rail are so important in bringing attention to areas which are underserved. For example, I recently joined residents of Winchborough, a village in West Lothian, in delivering a petition to the Minister for Connectivity, Jim Fairley, calling on the Scottish Government to name a date for the opening for a train station there. Residents and developers were granted planning permission in principle for the station 12 years ago. Yet, the first growing village is losing out. The success of the campaign for station in Cove and Newton Hill is gaining these feasibility studies with Liam Kerr's petition, which was signed by over 1,500 people, gives me a confidence that it is possible for progress to be made. To conclude, Presiding Officer, new rail stations prevent isolation of those living in our rural communities and bring tourists to places they would have previously ignored. Scotland has great potential for new rail all over the country, whether that be Winchborough, Fraserburgh or Cove. Rail travel is good for the environment, good for the economy and good for people. I welcome this motion and hope a successful outcome of the studies. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Chaudhry. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Willie Rennie. Around 4 minutes, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I apologise to the Chamber as I may have to leave before the conclusion of the debate for a previous commitment. I'd like to start by thanking Liam Kerr for bringing this debate forward. This is an issue which we have a common interest in as North East MSPs. The Nestrans announcement that new rail stations at Cove and Newton Hill are to be examined in more detail as part of the work to develop sustainable travel between Aberdeen and Lawrence Kirk is extremely welcome. And as Liam Kerr has outlined, Cove is a residential area on the south side of Aberdeen. Newton Hill is a commuter town a little further south. Both are in my constituency and both have historically had train stops serving the local populations. And I myself have supported these improvements since I was a councillor in the Tory Ferry Hill ward of Aberdeen City, and indeed I campaigned for the reinstatement of the train stops as part of my election campaign to the Scottish Parliament. And I have since remained focused and active on this issue, and indeed more recently written to the now Cabinet Secretary seeking her support in this matter. And I know Mr Kerr has been equally passionate and active on this issue. Presiding Officer, I think the question to be asked and answered here is why do we have such consensus on this issue? The Parliament is, of course, aware of the critical role of the North East, the critical role that the North East plays in our national economy. A skilled workforce is spread across a number of communities, which were once standalone small towns and villages, but which are now home to considerably bigger populations. And these communities continue to grow with further development situated or near these communities. Regional transport links to the south of Aberdeen are primarily road-based, with the exception of the Aberdeen to Central Belt rail links. And as we continue to transition to a greener economy, people have become conscious of the need to consider alternative, more green travel options. Local bus companies have delivered on green transport options, with both electric and hydrogen fleets expanding rapidly in recent times and serving communities across the area. North East communities at Newton Hill and Cove, as well as those further north along the Ellen and Peterhead corridor, are aware of the post-beaching cuts to their communities, and to one extent or another, the infrastructure still exists that would make modern transport links viable again. The communities of Cove and Newton Hill, like others in the North East, are seeking innovative connectivity locally, with wider regional centres and beyond. Proposals for electrification and opening new rail links closed under beaching offer the multimodal options which our communities are now seeking as a necessary part of 21st century living. Presiding Officer, a previous Nestrans study on multimodal transport along the Aberdeen to Lawrence Kirk corridor indicated a clear willingness from residents to support improvements to the rail network, which I believe opening the stations at Cove and Newton Hill would bring. And where similar improvements have progressed, such as at Kintore, previously mentioned by members, it has become clear very quickly that projects to deliver local transport infrastructure make a significant positive difference to local residents. To put the Kintore improvements into focus, the last figures for journeys to and from the station provide passenger numbers of around 85,000 per annum, with a population half of that of the combined populations of Newton Hill and Cove. And so Kintore has shown us the way forward to provide travel options for our communities, and this can and should be replicated elsewhere. And I hope the Nestrans appraisal brings forward a positive case for Cove and Newton Hill stations. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. I now call Willie Rennie to be followed by Tim Eagle. Around 4 minutes, Mr Rennie.
I thank Liam Kerr for bringing this debate and for making a very compelling case, as is Audrey Nicholl just at the moment. I think I know Newton Hill and Cove very well. They are large and growing communities. They are very mobile communities, and I think there is a very powerful case for just allowing the trains to stop through those communities. We're not talking about new railway lines, we're just stop the trains in those communities to let the passengers on. So relatively low-cost options for quite a big impact, which I would regard as the same for Newborough in my constituency, not in the far north-east as I would regard it, certainly in north of the Central Belt, because Fifers in the north-east of Fife don't regard ourselves as Central Belters. But I want to make the powerful case, I think, that has been developed by the campaign in Newborough in Fife. It's got huge local support, as is Newton Hill and Cove. They're united. Young and old are really motivated by this campaign, and it's gathered support from neighbouring communities as well, like Abernethy over into Perth and Kinross. The low cost, I think high impact, is very clear in this case. It would mean a 12-minute journey to Ladybank or to Perth. The railway line runs right through the borough. They are proposing a modular station, which would be relatively low cost. And it's a part of Fife that's quite cut off from other parts. For those who don't know, it's right on the Tay estuary. And there's a big potential economic boost because it's not the wealthiest part of my constituency. And there's a big move now towards more estuary living. And this fits right into that potential. So I think the economic boost that would be brought to that part of Fife would be significant, and that certainly was one of the strong arguments, I believe, for the Leave and Mouth campaign, was the economic boost that it would bring to that part of Fife. And I do congratulate the government for getting that scheme up and running, and it will be open within days, and I think that will be great for the east of Fife. And I think the case for that there was that it would be bringing significant economic developments. But we can't just rest on our laurels with that. There is a shortage of finance, as Kevin Stewart has highlighted. So we need to identify schemes that are quite low cost, but will have a big impact. And I think both Newton Hill and Cove and Newborough and my constituency meet that criteria. But the process is incredibly slow, especially for this low cost process. The budget that SESTRANS has set aside for this has already been blown apart because of the extra requirements that's been placed upon them by Transport Scotland. They first submitted their stag in June 2022. It took 6 months for comments to come back from the government. They resubmitted their proposal, and it took another 6 months for comments to come back, and we're going on and on. I suspect that process will carry on for a very long time. So I hope that the Minister would perhaps reflect on the fact that there seems to be a disproportionate time and cost involved for schemes that are actually relatively low cost, but again, quite a big impact. So I hope that we could perhaps adjust the process to make sure that schemes like Newborough have got a better chance of progressing much more quickly. Because as I say, the government has made some good progress on Leave and Mouth and other schemes, but there will be a dearth of schemes coming through now. And I hope that they identify that low-cost, high-impact schemes are something that they should be adopting. So I would urge the Minister to reflect on the process, to look again at Newborough and advance Newborough up the priority list alongside Newton Hill and Cove. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. I now call Tim Eagle to be followed by Karen Adam. Around 4 minutes, Mr Eagle.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer. And my thanks also to Liam Kerr for bringing this. I must admit, I didn't know he was a train buff, but we'll pick on that later on. But he brings an important debate, doesn't he, about how we need to be proactive, or the government needs to be proactive, about connecting communities on the rail network as they expand and grow across the whole of Scotland, and particularly acute for myself up in Moray. In fact, after this debate, I'm going to be running down to the train station at Waverley to get a train right the way back to the very north in Keith. So as we approach May, the sun rising on the horizon, the warmth in the air, I don't really want to talk about Christmas, but I was wondering if I should contact some of my constituents in Oban and the Argyll and Bute who have contacted me about what they are now calling the Polar Express on the West Highland Line, which is so cold in the mornings that they are wrapping themselves up in sleeping bags. And perhaps they should get some sponsorship from ScotRail in order to do a live-action remake of Every Day on the run-up to Christmas. It's an important point that they're raising, not just because of the health concerns around hypothermia on that line, but that we need a modern infrastructure, not just for the stations, but the rolling stock that we have. And I hope that we will see that situation remedied very soon. It was reported in the Oban Times recently, and I'm glad of that report because it brings to light the concerns not just in Oban, but across the Highlands and Islands, which I represent. It's great to hear from Liam Kerr that the populations of Cove and Newton Hill have expanded considerably in recent years, and with that, they most certainly warrant those new train stations that he's asking for. Conversely, however, many communities across the Highlands and Islands region, which I represent, are witnessing alarming rates of depopulation, in part because of a lack of infrastructure, investment in such infrastructure. Argyll and Bute is at particular risk, with a report published by Spice in 2022 showing that Argyll's islands experienced the highest depopulation in Scotland over the last 20 years. The Isle of Bute was worst hit, and it, of course, is heavily reliant on both a ferry service and rail infrastructure at Weems Bay. But this issue is affecting all parts of my region, and more investment is needed. This was recognised during the initial option appraisal carried out as part of the Strategic Transport Project Review too. That initial process was very forward-thinking. It suggested that there could be a new rail connection to and from Cow to the West Highland Line and also to Kintyre through the use of fixed links. It suggested improved rail connectivity between Oban and London through the introduction of a sleeper service. That would have been very welcome over there and would have helped with tourism as well. It even suggested that the rail network could be extended to the islands via fixed links. But disappointingly, none of these suggestions made it to the final recommendations in the report. No new stations, no new lines. In the end, that report only recommended corridor enhancement to the Highland Main Line, basically passing places. That's all it recommended in the end. That, for me, is a massive missed opportunity to the Scottish Government. However, all is not lost. Hytrans announced a consultation on its new draft regional transport strategy, which sets out a 20-year vision for transport improvements across the Highlands and Islands. I particularly welcome its support for the planning and delivery of new railway stations. The devil, of course, will be in the detail, but this is hopeful news for the Highlands and Islands. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Highlands and Islands needs more train stations, but it also needs wider investment across the board on infrastructure, especially if we are to tackle the real issues of rural depopulation. And I would love it if we could cure once and for all our Polar Express.
Thank you very much, Mr. Eagle. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Sue Webber. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank Liam Kerr for bringing this debate to the Chamber. It wasn't too long ago, I think we were walking the Buchan Line together in the northeast sunshine, which does happen, with the then Transport Minister, Jenny Gilruth. Because of that meeting, that my team and the Campaign for North East Rail were at, we had discussions in regards to the Just Transition Fund. And actually, a member of my team suggested that the Campaign for North East Rail apply for this. So I must say and put on record that the Scottish Government has been a great supporter of the Campaign for North East Rail and in every conversation that I've brought to them in that regard, and particularly awarding them £250,000 from the Just Transition Fund for that feasibility study to explore the possibility of passenger and freight services running north of Dyce, onwards towards Peterhead and Fraserburgh. And we will be expecting the findings of that feasibility study very soon. I recently held a survey which received more than 1,000 responses, and 2 in 5 of them said they relied on bus services to attend NHS appointments. We know that bus journeys to ARI take 2 or 3 times as long as car journeys. Connecting our coast is about more than transport. It's necessary for the health, safety and well-being of my constituents. From carbon capture projects to wind farms, our North East Corner is playing a vital role in delivering Scotland's transition to net zero, but that means HGV levels on the roads remain consistently high, and that's every hour of every day of the working week. The key difference between the Campaign for North East Roads study compared to previous studies is the key focus on rail freight opportunities in the area. Reconnecting Fraserburgh and Peterhead to the railway would allow many of these HGV movements transferred to the rails, resulting in cleaner air, fewer emissions, safer roads and further economic growth opportunities. Peterhead and Fraserburgh have been identified as regeneration priority areas. Unemployment in Fraserburgh and Peterhead is higher than the national average. So we have a chance here to replicate the success that we've seen in other schemes, such as the Borders Railway, and bring real regeneration to some of the most deprived areas in Aberdeenshire. The Peterhead South Pier, operated by ASCO, is the largest offshore support facility in Europe, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will join me in celebrating the fantastic news this week that the world's biggest offshore floating wind farm is set to be built just off the coast of Peterhead. This project will bring billions to Scotland's economy, the Blue Toon and the Broch, as affectionately known. Peterhead and Fraserburgh will be vital to this site, and they will expect heavy equipment, parts and specialised workers coming to the area once this wind farm is up and running. Yes, I will.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. I think it's great news for Peterhead. But does projects like that not just make the need for improvements like Tola Burness even more vital, and the government really need to get on with that because it is a real safety issue?
Karen Adam.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I do support any calls for road improvements and infrastructure in the North East, but I'm going to get on to a point later in that in my speech. So I wholeheartedly welcome the growth in my constituency, but we must recognise that the existing infrastructure is already congested with HGV, bus and car traffic, and introducing rail will go a long way to providing much welcome relief. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude by asking the Scottish Government if they will continue to support the Campaign for North East Rail work by continuing to consider funding for this project, such as detailed operations options appraisal when analysis of the latest study is complete. But let me be clear here. We are putting, obviously, a lot of pressure on the Scottish Government to help and support, and as rightly so, and that is our job as constituency MSPs here. But the UK Government has a part to play in this as well. And if a fraction of the cost that was spent on high-speed rail south of the border was spent in the North East Corner, we wouldn't just have rail to Peterhead, to Fraserburgh. It could go to Banff and Buckie and beyond. We have the potential to make boom time for the North East and beyond, Presiding Officer, and I hope we all recognise and take full advantage of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Sue Webber, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Liam Kerr for bringing this debate to the Chamber this afternoon. Improving rail connections in the North East is not just a regional benefit, but will be a national benefit and a national priority. By enhancing the infrastructure in the North East, we not only foster local community cohesion, but also bolster the entire country's transport network. And members will be very aware that there are other initiatives across the country, including the campaign to open a train station on the existing main line in Winchborough in West Lothian. And this exemplifies strategic investments that can significantly contribute to broader economic and social development across Scotland. And the same benefits have been clearly articulated by the North East members here today, and specifically by Liam Kerr. Winchborough is a vibrant and growing community in West Lothian, which currently finds itself isolated from the national rail network because the trains pass on by, and as Willie Rennie mentioned, they don't stop there either. The lack of direct access severely restricts the ability of residents to reach essential medical services, pursue educational opportunities and connect with employment opportunities. The establishment of a new railway station would dramatically enhance connectivity, ease congestion in West Lothian and the west of Edinburgh, and support our ambitions to provide sustainable transport solutions. And I want to commend Winchborough Developments Limited for their commitment and substantial contributions towards making this vision a reality. Their involvement is a testament to the power of community and the corporate collaboration in driving forward public projects. And they too, along with the community of Winchborough, presented a petition of over 2,000 signatures to the Scottish Government. So again, this is reflected in terms of community empowerment with a petition that was presented by Cove and Newton Hill that had over 1,500 signatures. Winchborough Developments Limited is the principal landowner and has worked in partnership with Winchborough Community Council and the Community Development Trust. The developer has already funded a new junction on the M9 to alleviate congestion and has shown considerable commitment to expanding the community. It's now time for the Scottish Government to match that. And like Cove and Newton Hill, this region anticipates a significant population growth, up to 4,000 new families as a direct result of investment leveraged from the Edinburgh and South East Scotland City Region deal will move here. Demand for more robust public transport options has never been more urgent, and the area will continue to grow. The new station at Winchborough is essential. It's not only a necessity to alleviate mountain congestion here in our capital city, but a critical factor in meeting the Scotland Government's failing net zero ambitions. The pace of progress has been staggeringly slow and bogged down in bureaucracy. Despite repeated promises to do so, Transport Scotland still hasn't shared Network Rail's cost estimate or design estimate with the developer. This is delaying any realistic assessment the developer can make about how their contribution can be, and simply adds to the transport woes of the West Lothian community, which is getting larger by the month. But there could be some good news. This is a rare example of a station which won't need a wholly funded project from the public purse and will receive a generous contribution from the developer. Surely the Scottish Government should be pulling out all the stops to make that happen. Isn't that a model that could transform not just Winchborough, but so many of the badly needed infrastructure projects that we've heard about here this afternoon? So let me be quite clear. The needs of the community are obvious. The benefits of the project can be seen from either end of the crowded M8, and they all require urgent action from this SNP government to get something moving. No more meetings. No more talk about different types of meetings, just actual action. So I call yet again on Scottish ministers to actually do something. Re-establish the steering group to get this project moving and commit to a timetable to deliver a station to the communities around Winchborough without any furthermore obfuscation, I can't say that word today, or delay. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Webber. And I call on Fiona Hislop to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, around 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, firstly, can I thank Liam Kerr for raising the subject of new railway stations, in this case at Cove and Newton Hill. Can I also thank the efforts of Nestrans and their stakeholders in progressing the work undertaken to date on this transport appraisal, which I will come back to later. However, before I do, I thought I would offer my own reflections on the topic of the desire for a new railway station. I have received requests for new stations on an almost weekly basis since I took on the transport portfolio, and we've heard that, I think, in all the contributions today. I understand the desire of both Newton Hill and Cove communities to see trains calling again at these stations after almost 7 decades after their initial closure. Both communities and the Campaign for North East Railway have worked over the years to highlight the case for rail enhancements in the region, and I admire the ambition of any local rail campaign. And I know firsthand, as a constituency MSP, what a new rail station can do for an area, having campaigned successfully for new stations at Armidale and Blackridge as part of the Airdrie Bathgate line. And in my role as a constituency MSP, I am a firm, long-standing and continuing supporter for the campaign for the Winchborough railway station. The potential value and opportunities that a railway station can bring to a community has been proven again and again by our investment in rail. And I am therefore rightly proud of this government's record of opening new stations across Scotland, which stands at 18 to date and includes 2 in the northeast at Lawrence Kirk, opening in 2009, and Kintore, which we heard had opened in 2020. And this total is due to an increase by a further 2 in the coming weeks with the opening of the Levermouth rail line and its new stations at Cameron Bridge and Leven. And I have seen and heard what a new station means to a local community, having had the great pleasure of officially opening East Linton station back in December. However, despite the numerous requests that I see for new stations and the evidence of the benefits that they may bring, I need to temper these with the realities of the many other priorities for new rail investment against the unprecedented challenge we face with regards to our capital position. Now, if I can turn now to the work led by Nestrans in terms of the study of transport and travel between Lawrence Kirk and Aberdeen. I am aware that the Aberdeen to Lawrence Kirk multimodal study started life back in 2020 and was commissioned with funding from the Scottish Government's Local Rail Development Fund. And following initial work, the study has evolved to incorporate and include the wider regional aspirations for an Aberdeen rapid transit project. And this is the same corridor as the initial LRDF study and includes the A90 and A92 towards Aberdeen. Taking the previous work and the most recent options for Aberdeen Rapid Transit has taken the study to completion of the preliminary options appraisal report. The recommendations from this phase of work has been approved by the Nestrans Board in February and includes options for strategic active travel interventions, implementation of a mobility hub facility to the south of Aberdeen, bus priority measures and new rail stations in Cove and Newton Hill. As all of these options have scored sufficiently well against the study's transport planning objectives and other appraisal criteria, they have therefore met the necessary threshold to advance to the next stage, which is a detailed appraisal. So moving forward, and in line with the Scottish Transport Appraisal Guidance, the next stage of work will involve a detailed appraisal of those shortlisted packages. I would therefore expect to see these options further developed and their impact quantified as part of that assessment. Now, this may include the packaging of options to identify the most effective solution for the corridor. It is at this detailed appraisal stage that I would expect to see potential passenger demand forecasts for each option, together with the detailed cost estimates and the outcome of any public and stakeholder engagement, which I understand from my officials that Nestrans are currently expecting to do this summer. All of this evidence gathered and consideration of the further risks will be required as part of that detailed assessment. But let me be clear, even if the detailed appraisal concludes that one or both of the rail stations may have a strong case to move forward, and my officials agree, there are a number of hurdles that need to be cleared before it can progress. Now, top among them is affordability. And as I've said on numerous occasions in this chamber recently, our ambitions to invest in Scotland's infrastructure have been severely hampered by the UK Government's failure to inflation-proof their capital budget.
Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking that intervention. I'm listening carefully to the concerns about capital. Can you maybe explain what impact that's going to have on the £200 million investment that was meant to be made to reduce the journey times by 20 minutes by 2026? Is that now a project that is not going to be taken forward, because it seems that it hasn't moved very far in the 8 years?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member was in committee, and I think he actually asked Mary McCallum that very same point, and she talked about the need for us to review timescales. We have got commitments. I would say that the scope of that £200 million comprises of a series of infrastructure upgrades, including signal enhancement, station works at Aberdeen, Dundee, Montrose and Arbroath, new freight loops specific to enable the operation of more and faster trains on the same route, but of course Mr Kerr would want to use that for Cove and Newton Hill. I think that was the suggestion from him. Very briefly.
Liam Kerr.
I'm genuinely grateful. On the capital point, when the line to Leven opens, which I think is the 2nd of June, there'll be only one station committed, which I think is Ball Grey, and I think that's being funded through the Glasgow City deal. Is that level of funding something that's being considered for Cove and Newton Hill?
Cabinet Secretary, I can give you the time back for the intervention.
Thank you very much. Now, I think that we have to be realistic. There is a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion to our budget. So there are challenges to complete existing commitments. And obviously, we've got additional commitments coming on top of that. That is why it's actually more important than ever that we do get those strong business cases in terms of those stag appraisals and that detailed appraisal come through. And it's therefore, for this reason, I must be assured of the robustness of the study's final recommendations from Nestrans, particularly given that the work is now being funded through the Aberdeen City Region deal and that there may be calls for further Scottish Government investment in order to implement its recommendations. Now, I would reiterate that any changes to any City Region deal has to be agreed by all the partners, and I think everybody's acknowledging of that. So, President Officer, in conclusion, this Government remains committed to investing in our railways, including the opening of new station, where there's a strong business case to do so, and I think we have committed and demonstrated our commitment to the North East, not least by the contribution I think made by Karen Adam in terms of the rail line that she is pursuing. But let me be clear, it is vital that whichever option emerges from this Nestrans detailed appraisal, it needs to be backed by a strong evidence base supporting a business case for future investment. Without this, and without wishing to prejudice the outcomes of this work, this will be critical if that option is to require government support. So I do look forward to the conclusion of the detailed appraisal phase and the outcome of the work. I want to congratulate everybody involved in campaigning for Cove and Newton Hill, not least the communities that are involved, because I am, and I know from my knowledge, that they will be passionate about wanting to secure that. And I'm sure, like me, Nestrans focus on making sure that the North East can achieve its ambitions for transport that it so rightly deserves can come to a conclusion that I, and I'm sure the campaigners, would hope would be successful.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.